Well, hey, everyone. Welcome to Framework Leadership, a podcast about principles and ideas you can use today to take your leadership to the next level. I'm your host, Kent Engel, president of Southeastern University.
And I'm your co-host, Michael Steiner, vice president for innovation.
And it is exciting to introduce our guest for today's show, Kayleigh McEnany. And Kayleigh, political commentator, author, you served at the White House as press secretary, senior advisor during President Trump's administration. Currently on Fox News as co-host of Outnumbered, formerly national spokesperson for the Republican National Committee. I mean, it is an honor to have you with us today.
Thank you. It's great to be home. I was raised in Plant City, Florida. I went to school in Tampa. So this area is home for me. It's great to be back.
We're glad to have you back. Now, obviously, I want to start this conversation talking about what's coming up. We have the election coming up with the midterms. What do you predict's going to happen? Is there going to be a red wave coming? Or
I think so. And what has been interesting, if you read, Nate Cohn over at the New York Times, who's pretty good analyst of these things, he wrote a piece recently about polling and whether the polling industry is off once again. And he made the really good point. We all know the polling industry was off in 2016. No polls showed President Trump prevailing. But they were also off in 2020 by big margins. They had President Biden winning states by 16 points that he won by 1 or 2 points.
Right.
So the modeling has really been off. And he posits that the same flaws in polling in the last 8 years are present here. And it's interesting to consider a polling flaw in the context of polls that show Republicans leading on the generic ballot. Republicans are leading by 3 points, by 2 points, depending on the poll you look, which could mean more like 7 or 8 points. But when you really whittle it down to battleground districts, Republicans are leading by even more.
Wow.
So I know conventional wisdom is that Dobbs was decided and abortion will decide the election. I don't think that's the case. I think it will be the bread and butter economic issues. Crime is now a number two issue. It's kind of where education was the issue in Virginia last year.
Right.
It's still an issue, but crime is really coming up.
Mm-hmm.
So I think Republicans take the House by quite a few seats. The Senate could really go either way, but I think that Republicans eke it out by maybe one seat, 51-49.
If you think, that'll be great. That'll be awesome.
It would be great.
In this situation. But is there anything you think could happen between now and the midterms that could push it either way? Is there any kind of X factors? I mean, those are always kind of the things that you can't quite predict, but what could happen?
I think that's a great question. Gas prices.
Yeah.
Just this week, anything can happen. Of course, they call it October surprises.
Mm-hmm.
But what happened this week, I think, was really unfortunate, but also very consequential electorally, where OPEC, after the Biden administration essentially begging on their hands and knees for weeks and weeks, CNN published a piece about the backdoor efforts of the Biden administration dispatching Janet Yellen, the Treasury Secretary, to try to convince Gulf nations not to cut barrels of production. And we all remember the fist bump with the Saudi Arabian prince. Well, fist bump diplomacy didn't work, and OPEC cut 2 million barrels. Biden had to pull from the strategic reserve, and gas prices, which are already ticking back up, it appears they may tick up even more, unfortunately.
Yep.
And those kind of issues right before, 32 days before midterm election, that can spell doom.
Yep.
Yeah. I want to discuss the future of the Republican Party, especially after President Trump's administration. Where do you think that's going, and what do you personally think has changed with conservative American values in this process?
I think one of the things that changed, President Trump changed politics forever, not just Republican politics. It was the first time we moved from, I call them mannequin type candidates, where you were expected to fit a certain profile, to speak a certain way, to not be off the cuff. He threw all of that out the window and just said, I'm going to be authentic for better or worse. This is who I am. Take it or leave it. The style has changed, where you're seeing candidates who are kind of just looser, more in their own skin, not the pressure to be a robotic type mannequin candidate, but just being authentic. We see that in our governor, who does a really great job at that, Governor Ron DeSantis. So I think the style has changed, but what he's done for conservatism is make a party that's responsive to the people. When you look at some of the decisions he made as president, I would argue no Republican president, probably in modern history, maybe Reagan, but outside of him, would have been as crossing the T, dotting the I of every campaign promise, as President Trump was. For instance, getting out of the Paris Climate Accord. The political establishment on both sides said he's not actually going to do that as president. Getting out of the Iran deal, he's not actually going to do that as president. Appointing justices that ended up overturning Roe v. Wade, he's not going to do that. Each and every issue, he did exactly what he said. So I think he raised the standard for voters, probably in both parties, because we've seen the surgence of the Bernie Sanders wing of the party that, even though I don't agree ideologically, they're principled in the same way in their views. Trump is principled in his views. I think on both wings, you've seen this like resurgent force of, if you set it on the campaign trail, we expect you to do it. Right. So I think forevermore, you will see candidates like Ron DeSantis, like Donald Trump, who in office are as conservative as they were on the campaign trail.
And I think one of the other big phenomenons for Trump's presidency specifically is how much he made conservative values more attractive to people who have never thought about it before, right?
Great point.
I mean, we think about guys like Elon Musk and Joe Rogan. These are not people who you would put in the camp of conservative values, yet they're starting to champion things like free speech, all those different stuff. What's your perspective on this? And how does having guys like this in the driver's seat of things like Twitter change the future for conservatives in this country?
I think that's a fantastic point. Look, and you see it with Governor DeSantis, too, where the things he's done are very conservative, and the political media establishment are stunned to see him leading by 11 points in Florida.
Right.
11 points. I believe that would be the highest margin of victory if he prevails by double digits like that in Florida in modern history. And people are astounded because it is it's full on conservative. This isn't middle of the road. This is conservative politics. And I think you know, you see that exactly right trickle into the Joe Rogans, the Elon Musk, who say, you know, we're expected to think in a doctrinaire way in corporate America and social media and in big media. And people have just rejected this tyranny of the elite where you're expected to embrace liberal politics. And I think it's because they've overreached. And people look and they say, I don't think my kindergartner should be taught about sexuality. I think parents should be teaching that common sense.
Right.
I don't believe in drag queens at my child's school. These are things that it doesn't matter what side of the aisle you're on. It's just basic. That's not the American way. That's not what we teach our children. Leave it to parents to make those decisions, not teachers and not school administration. So because they've overreached so much on so many issues, not just education, I think you're seeing common sense kind of echoed in the Joe Rogans, the Elon Musk, and their rejection of the status quo and kind of the liberal elite.
I
want to talk a little bit about your background. Before becoming White House press secretary, you began your media career as a producer for Huckabee on Fox News and later worked as a commentator on CNN. Talk about these experiences that you had prior to the Trump administration. How did those positions kind of set you on course for your role at the White House?
They were a battleground, a testing place, kind of a where the iron against iron sharpens iron, they say. I know that's a Christian principle, but I'm going to use it in a different context of, for instance, being at CNN, you know, being in a place where you could kind of analogize it to being in front of a hostile White House press corps. When you're on a panel with eight people, including the host, who very clearly is embracing the liberal side of the aisle, you have to learn how to bring your facts, bring footnotes. You, in the world of television, you know, people have talking points, but it's so much, you realize being at a hostile environment like CNN, talking points aren't enough. You need a fact, a figure, a statistic, because your point is going to be scrutinized by eight people at one time screaming over you. And perhaps you get 15 seconds to say your one point. So I think being in those testing scenarios, you know, I mentioned when I was at SEU giving my speech, Alan Combs, who was a liberal who became a mentor to me, just a wonderful man, different than me ideologically, but told me, don't fight fire with fire, fight fire with water, after he watched me on CNN. And it taught me that, you know, if Jim Acosta is shouting a question at me or Caitlin Collins or eight people on CNN, if I am calm in my demeanor, smart in my delivery and factual in what I bring to the table, the American people will listen. And, you know, after my time at CNN, one of the greatest compliments I would get is I sometimes would have people on the other side of the aisle come up to me and say, I don't agree with what you said, but I like the way you said it. So I stopped and listened. And I think when you can achieve that, it means that in your presentation, you're opening the minds of people who are at least taking the time to listen to the point of view of the administration.
Yeah. And you have an incredible educational career, right, through Harvard Law School, then through Oxford. And I love the story you were telling earlier at our leadership forum when we were talking about how you had to present papers and had people already attacking it, pulling it down. How much did your educational experiences prepare you for your work that you've done?
A lot. Mm-hmm. Academia, when I was there, was a great place to be for a conservative. And now that may seem counterintuitive, mm-hmm. Because there's no doubt it was liberal at Harvard, Georgetown, at Oxford. But it advantaged me mm-hmm. as a conservative to constantly have my worldview challenged, my faith challenged, mm-hmm. my political viewpoints challenged, my international relations thoughts challenged. It advantaged me because I was, in the same way at CNN, mm-hmm. I was forced to bring footnotes and data points. Yeah. I was forced to do so in academia at a much higher scale when you're writing a 20-page paper than preparing for a cable news segment. So I say I was advantaged in being a conservative because, you know, if you were a liberal on some of these campuses, you went through life unchallenged. Wow. You didn't have your viewpoint challenged. But now, and I saw this in my very last year of law school, academia, I fear, has gotten to such a point where there's not that free flow of conversation where professors used to encourage that. And it's not even so much, it's some professors, mm-hmm. but it's a lot of times the student body where in my final year of law school, if you expressed a different view, you were ostracized from the community. Yeah. You weren't welcome. You were demonized. And I really hate that that's the direction academia has gone in because I really appreciated the back and forth of ideas. At Oxford, for example, I was there when Barack Obama was elected. Mm. Obviously not a happy day for me. But for hours, we stayed up, my classmates and I, and they picked my brain like a little science experiment. How do you think this way? You know, why did you support Mitt Romney? But it was fun and it was intellectual. And it's sad to see those days kind of ending on academic campuses.
Yeah. No, we saw that. We had Kristen Wagner here. She was our commencement speaker in May. You know, and she was at Yale, and that demonstration of the students, I mean, literally they had to bring police in, and it was just wild. Because, and who was she? She was debating
Another professor at Yale that actually invited
on her. Free speech.
Wow. On free speech.
And the students were, you know, just taking over the space, and they couldn't, you know, and both of them were actually in agreement, you know, that they can debate this in a civil way. But the students would allow it. And you know, we have amazing students that come our way. And these students, they want to get involved. They want to step off the sidelines and be civically engaged and be able to share. We see a lot of young people getting involved in politics and sharing their views on social media. What do you think the upcoming generation has to offer when it comes to that? What do you think are their strengths and maybe even some of their weaknesses when they engage with social media?
I think social media is a microcosm that takes away the human face.
Sure.
And because it does that, it allows for untold levels of hatred, of vitriol, of cruelty. And it's been, in many ways, a net negative. Yes, we're more connected than ever before, but people are also more hostile than ever before. I it's really kind of been a cancer on society in so many ways, and not just in this place. But, you know, the next generation, I'm a millennial, I will say. I know there are younger generations, but my generation, unfortunately, got a bad rap. I love my generation. We're enterprising, smart, hardworking, happened to graduate in the Great Recession with Obama in 2008. And many of my colleagues couldn't find jobs for the degrees they sought, even though they were trying their best. Yeah. But we got the reputation of being the kids in our parents' basement when a lot of kids just graduated during a really hard economic time. So what I say to the even younger generations, you don't know what a hard economy looks like unless you graduated in the millennial generation. And I know now there are ample jobs for, you know, all young people, but that's not always the case.
Right.
So what I say to even the younger generation is know the opportunities you have are vast. Pursue your dreams.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But no, it's not always so easy, and take advantage of really the sea of opportunity that you have at your mm-hmm. doorstep.
Yeah. And then what about students, you know, that are resonate with you, right? Maybe they have that conservative background. They were raised in a particular home and they're stepping into new college campuses, different things like that. How can they stay firm in what they've been taught and what they've been put up in those situations.
Yeah, know where you stand and be principled. I think listen to the other side. I certainly did. I listened to the other side of the argument. And there are times when the other side of the argument is right. And you can acknowledge those moments and be open-minded. But stay firm to who you are. You know, for me, I always say my worldview is I was a Christian, Israel-loving conservative who went into the field of foreign policy and had my viewpoint challenged. And I graduated a Christian, Israel-loving conservative, even though I was challenged. My former tutor at Oxford was a member of the Palestinian Liberation Organization. She thought very differently than me. I still maintain my views on geopolitics, but I learned about the other side of the argument, and it brings humanity to any situation, either international relations, politics, to listen. So you can stay firm and principled, but if you bring a fact with you to the argument rather than... which unfortunately it all too often descends into this, kind of the ad hominem attacks.
Right.
We even saw it in the press briefing room, which is unfortunate.
Yeah.
Refrain from the ad hominem attacks, bring a fact with you. And at the end of the day, you'll leave more principled than you than you came oftentimes.
Yeah. Well, that's a good point that like students don't have to be afraid of a challenge. And I think that's this big, there's this myth that's out there that the challenge of the college campus is something scary, something to be avoided. But oftentimes, like you said, you can go through these challenges and still remain faithful. That's your choice on that part of it. How can parents really encourage their students to maintain and be faithful to those points?
I think that's so important. You know, I was advantaged in that I grew up in a family where on Sundays I was at my Southern Baptist church, on Wednesdays I was at youth group, and on Monday through Friday I was at my Catholic school. And so my dad was instilling in me principles along the way that equipped me when I left for college and I did have my viewpoint challenged. I had so many facts at my fingertips. So I think, you know, as I'm raising my daughter, I worry a lot. You know, I'm a parent, so I finally understand what my parents went through. And you worry because it's scary sending your daughter to a school and the things they're teaching in elementary schools, like the kind of backlash against Governor DeSantis, who just said in K through 3 education, we're leaving sexuality to the parents, not to the teachers. So basic. I mean, when people are truly polled on the language of the bill, 70% of people support it because it's such common sense. But I'm going to be spending time with my daughter, taking her to church. We go to church together on Sundays. I read her a devotional every night before she goes to bed. My husband and I, we pray together. So when my daughter leaves, the same way my faith was in my heart and in my mind, it's going to be in hers. So no matter how out of control 17 years from now, I can't even imagine, or 15 years from now, our college campuses get, I hope there's a sea change. But if there's not, she'll be ready because she'll have two parents who spent time with her, teaching her this is the right way, and here's why, and demonstrating that through acts of love.
That's so good. And you are a person of strong faith, and that faith informs how you do everything in your role, but I know there are so many moments that you faced a lot of hostile people and environment, especially as a press secretary. How did you personally stand firm in your faith despite those circumstances?
Yeah, you know, it's a great question. I mean, I think my training helped me, which we went through a little bit. But before the last thing we did, and your son Davis was on my team in the White House, what an extraordinary son that you've raised. But he can attest the last thing that we did in my press secretary office before going to the podium was to say a prayer. And that really behooved us more than any of the hours and hours of preparation we put in. Because when we walked to the podium, had all of the facts that we had been through, but more than that, the ability to stay calm. I remember a theologian saying before, remember that behind every question is a questioner. And that questioner has all sorts of reasons for the way they're acting, hurts in their lives, things that have happened. So if they get hostile, remember it's a human being behind the question. And I think when you can maintain that really Christian perspective of the way you interact with other individuals, it helps you to take a breath in the moments when you're being attacked. Like, and then the attacks did get personal about, unfortunately, and I think this is so unproductive for the country. And it wasn't every reporter. It was a handful who would wage personal attacks about your character. You know, I'm a press secretary standing up there communicating the viewpoint of an administration. I'm not putting myself out there. I'm putting forward a viewpoint from an administration. Sure. But it got so personal in a way that's fallen away during the Biden administration, which is good. Yeah. But we know there's a different standard that's very evident in the way questions are asked of a Republican press secretary and a Democrat one. Go watch the questions.
Right.
It's very different.
And that, you know, reminds me a verse, and we often talk about it here in how we respond and react to all the issues and challenges. But that verse that Paul writes, 1 Corinthians 16:13, where he says, be on guard, stand firm in the faith, be strong, be courageous. But then he says, but do everything with love.
Yes.
And you approach it that way, and somehow it diffuses, you know, a lot of what happens just by that demeanor that you approach, and you're so good at that, and yeah, so grateful for your faith and
thank
how you've
you.
Stood firm in it.
It's a great verse, and you know, the one I always refer to is the two, always give a reason for the hope that you have, but do so with gentleness and respect. Such sage words, right?
Yeah,
timeless
exactly.
words that seem to be applicable on our college campuses and at a White House press podium.
Well, we're going to move into our fire round, and that's where we ask some quick questions and get some quick gut reactions, and this helps us to grab a few practical and applicable pieces of advice for all of those who are listening in today. Michael, I'll let you ask. We're just going to ask three quick questions, and Michael, I'll ask you to fire away.
Fire away. Okay, so first question. Obviously, with your career, you had to do a lot to prepare yourself for the next door that came. What advice would you give to people that are, you know, students or different early career professionals to be ready for opportunities when they come their way?
I think, you know, always, especially if you're interning, be useful to your boss in that you go above and beyond. You know, a lot of times interns, they come into an office, don't know how to interact in a situation. Maybe they're being given small tasks. Well, rise to the occasion. You know, I remember being a Fox News intern. Sorry, it's a little bit longer an answer. I'll make it quicker. I was an intern at Fox, and I said, you know what? I could make my boss's job easier if I wrote the opening script for Hannity. Big task for an intern. Started setting it on his desk, He goes, this is pretty good. And then he let me write it every day. He'd edit it, of course.
Yeah.
But then he gave me the responsibility of going in and helping to produce the introduction. Just a small anecdote about kind of going above and beyond in your internships and your jobs. And people really notice if you're that kid that takes the extra step.
Love it.
Okay. This is a question we ask a lot. If you could sit down with any leader, past or present, who would that be and why?
President Ronald Reagan, one of the greatest presidents in American modern history, and Margaret Thatcher, you know, as a woman, you can't help but love her.
Yeah.
And I would add in there the queen, who you managed to have both the right and the left love you and adore you, and you're the steadfast presence in British society. It's pretty remarkable, and a great Christian.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. In fact, you know, a lot of that was brought out. In this celebration of her life, her faith. So, powerful.
If I could add Billy Graham in there, too.
Yes. There we go. Love it. Love it. Last question for us. What's one piece of advice you would give your 21-year-old self?
Oh, wow. Oh, I know exactly what. Mm. Trust God. He has your path. Because when you're a go-getter and an overachiever, you wonder why a door slammed in your face. And now I look back, and every door that was slammed in my face, there was a reason, and I would have saved myself a lot of anxiety and worry if I would have just trusted from the get-go.
Love it.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Kayleigh, for being on this podcast, and just so admire you. And you know, I love your latest book, you know, for such a time as this, that you talk about how, you know, God has placed you in roles because, again, he created you, designed you in a way to use you that will influence a lot of people's lives.
Thank you.
And you do that, and we're so grateful for that.
Well, I'm honored. Thank you so much for having me. Southeastern University is just a beautiful campus, amazing staff, and the kids who go here have been so impressive. So at SEU, you are doing everything right.
Thank you. I appreciate that. If you want to stay, following Kayleigh, we want to make sure that we, your Twitter handle, Instagram, what's the best way we can have our listeners follow you if they want to get more?
Just at Kayleigh McEnany, and that's Instagram, Twitter, True Social, everywhere.
Okay.
Yep, just the
name. Perfect. Well, we want to thank you for joining us on Framework Leadership today. Take care, everybody.
Thank you.